Hello and welcome along to another Where's My Kit Bag podcast featuring the three lovely video technicians of the Sixth Form College Farnborough with myself, James.
Me, Will.
And I'm Steve.
How are we, boys?
You're pretty good.
Very well. Doing pretty good for a Wednesday.
Anything exciting on the cards?
Well, we'll have to see in the pod.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Oh! Tension build. Look at that. It's like we're professionals.
I'm getting there.
Although we did all go to the cinema last night to watch a film, but that'll be...
That'll be later.
That'll be in the old What Have We Been Watching, where we can all say the same thing for once.
Nice. Oh, I think we should do a spoiler warning on this one, seeing as all three of us have seen it.
That's very true. Why, do you want the official spoiler sound?
Oh, not yet.
Well,
not
yet,
because
we're going to talk about it. All right,
Pre-spoiler warning.
Yeah.
Anywho, Steve.
Hello.
Do you have any departmental news by any chance?
I've got some. Hello.
Nice.
I thought I'd do the opposite of news anchor. No, there's actually quite a bit on over the next like fortnight coming up to the old Crimbo. So first and foremost, for those film club people out there, The Devil's Backbone will be screening on the 2nd of December at 4:30 in the Simon Jarvis Lecture Theatre. That is Monday, this coming Monday, as of recording this podcast. The 2nd of December, 4:30, Simon Jarvis Lecture Theatre. This is an important one because we need to get an idea of numbers to find out if it's going to go ahead next term, CASA 2020. And it's really down to numbers at this screening. So come along, show your face, even if, you know, you just want to say, yeah, I'm interested, but I don't want to watch the film. Just come and let us know. Because we need a certain number. Not going to tell you the number, but we need a certain number to make it viable. I'm looking forward to it. I'll be in attendance because I want to see the film. It's The Devil's Backbone, the Del Toro film. Not seeing it myself, but I'm going to stick around and have a little watch.
Is it quite a modern film?
2001, I believe. Could be wrong on that. But, yes. As I said, not seen it. Watch trailer, looks pretty good. So yeah, come along, even if it's just to show your face. You know, you might not have a train until 5:30. You might want to just watch the first half of the film, check out the rest of it in your own time, you know. Come along, socialise. Well, by socialise, I mean come watch a film with us, which would be good. More on that, expect an email to the entire media and film department in the next coming days. And yeah, it's open to all students as well. So if you've got somebody over in, you know, maths who's like, oh, I want to watch that film, bring them along, no problem with that. What's next? Oh, it's actually a question. Nice. I guess it's just there's a lot going on in the edit and IT suites at the moment.
We've got creative kickstart going on, haven't we?
That's third on my list.
Oh,
let's go with that. Let's start with that. Okay, boys, I have a question for both of you.
Hello there.
Because I haven't been to one, so I don't know. Ooh. How were your creative kickstart talks? Starting with you, Bale, how'd it go? What was it like? What did you attend?
Very nice. I was hosting Azana Films, who we met last year. No, this year, but last academic year, with the Fleet Film Film Screening Film Society Club thing, short film competition thing they had going on. And we met, So two people run Azana Films. There's a guy called Azim. There's a guy called Elham. So we met Azim at the Fleet Film short film screenings, and we thought, this guy's cool. We'll keep in contact with him. And then obviously Creative Kickstarter came up, and we're like, that Azim guy seemed cool. Let's get him in. This time he brought along his the co-founder of Azana Films, Elham, with him as well, who also stars in their main short film. It's really good. I took some marking along with me, you know, to, you know, multitask, listen in, do some marking. I did absolutely zero marking at all because they were so they were so engrossing. What they were saying was so good. All the students that were there were asking like great questions for them. It was just a really nice, exciting Q&A of how they actually put together their short films, how they like get, you know, signed off budget wise, how they find locations, all this kind of stuff. Obviously, A-level film has been doing at the moment. So I thought it was very relevant, very good indeed.
Nice. What did you guys see, Will?
An ex-student, James Hastings, came in. He was a student here 3 years ago, 20 years old, and he's already made a feature film, and he's just funded and finished editing a short called Off the Coast, which was funded off $2,500 with a cast of 100 crew and cast.
God, I thought you said 100 cast members. I was like, geez.
Yeah, well, 100 cast and crew. So,
oh, man.
Yeah, it was quite a lot. Considering there was only about 6 crew, you can imagine it was actually quite a lot of cast in it. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Wow. And we got to see an early screening of it, which is quite good. 20 nice. Minutes short. It's going to be on the festival circuit. And he basically talks about how to make films and what his process was. So it was actually really interesting. How he is not solely relying on Kickstarter, other means he's had to kind of stretch to fund his products. Some of them might be a bit brutal, but if you're going to make it, you got to do it. That's how you're going to make it in the industry. That's really interesting. If you want to check him out, he's got his own website, Hastings Infinity Films, and you can see a lot of his work on there.
Nice.
Nice.
Do we know if there's any other talks that are worth going to? Or
oh, there are loads.
Yeah, I think they're finishing this week, aren't they?
Yeah, that's what I was curious if I don't want to...
No, I think there are a couple next week as well.
Oh, yeah, you're right,
a couple have been moved because of various professionals and lives having to obviously move and adapt with the moving media industry. So yeah, there are a few talks next week. If you have a look at the original email you would have got to sign up to stuff, there's a timetable of when all the events are going on and which talks you can go and see.
Nice. I guess the only other thing that's happening in the department is the ever so looming deadline for film. That's coming up in the next 2 weeks, I believe.
Yep.
So you'll probably find that the edit suite is getting busier, the IT suite is getting busier, and even if you're a film student, we don't have computers to accommodate every single one of you at the same time. So it's actually been really good this semester, half term, whatever you want to call it. They seem to be really getting on with it. So we're looking forward to the deadline looms. But at the moment, everything seems to be, would you say the ball is rolling?
Oh, yes, definitely.
At a good speed. All films are looking good.
Some very impressive stuff.
For film students out there, if you are doing your short film, don't leave it till the last minute. Keep going along. Don't have a little break and get that cut down.
Did you say deadline, Steve?
Deadline. Nice.
Nice.
Nice. Yeah, it's coming.
It is.
You can't
well, when
it.
Even is it? I don't even know when it is.
2 weeks Friday.
I believe
2 weeks
that.
Friday.
Yeah.
Ooh, that is close.
I believe.
It's interesting. I'm not
1 week Friday.
I'm not going to name any names, but I'm really curious. I said to you this morning, Will, of like, it's the same 15 students constantly booking out kit. I'm just really curious to see where these the students who have like never booked out kit, what their films look like.
Their hands will go up 2 days before the submission. can I have some help? Yeah, you need to reshoot your whole film. I've only got 2 days.
But I did it in an evening.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought that would be enough.
Yeah, well, we'll let you guys know in on the stories that we come across, yeah. I'm sure.
Shout out to you students who are like booking like every day, though. Like, fair play.
Big
like, it's a difficult task to continually shoot and reshoot. I know it's draining. We all know, being in the industry, it can be tough. You may be like, oh, I don't want to. This will do. But you get a better film if you reshoot.
Very true.
If necessary. That's it from Department News. It's quite a long one. But yeah, Film Club, 2nd of December, 4:30 p.m. Simon Jarvis, The Devil's Backbone. See you there. Steve signing off. Stay classy, Beacon Building. Got that in.
I love it. How about some tech news
me.
With you, Dev?
Let's go.
Drop straight
there
in.
There we go. Bam. Well, it was such a nice ending. I was just like, well, I'm not going to add anything else. Bam, there's a jingle. Shoot. Will Devro.
Oh, hello.
Tell us about tech.
Welcome to Tech News. So this week we've got some exciting stories to cover. Now, this one's been breaking the internet a little bit. It's the Tesla Cybertruck, as I'm sure we've all either heard, seen, or talked about somewhere in our lives at
literally
some point now.
Literally breaking.
Yeah, well, for a good one. Nice, like that. Rob Cam had the little comment today. He thought it might be a bit of a propaganda stunt, a bit of marketing Ooh. Prowess, which after thinking about it, I was like, you know what? That's really smart, and it's something that I might do, but it seems a bit crazy damning a product that you've got to have pretty good confidence in your customer base to like show your product not working and then still think it's going to go through okay. I'll explain what happened. So they've announced a Cybertruck. It is huge. It's like the size of a Hummer. And it's essentially very futuristic looking, huge power numbers, very, very fast, made of the same stuff they're building their rockets out of. So it's basically, you can hit it. They did hit it with a sledgehammer, didn't leave a dent. Pretty cool. Bulletproof glass, but however, when they tested that on the stage, it didn't look too bulletproof. The little ball they threw out the window smashed into it. Didn't go all the way through, but it did crack both the front and rear windows. A bit painful.
I'm surprised. I was really surprised when he goes, it's bulletproof, that Elon didn't just whip out a gun and just fire it at it.
Can you imagine? I think that might have been a bit of uproar.
A little bit of uproar, but it's the kind of thing that wouldn't surprise me.
Probably because he should have got his flamethrower out, because they make those, don't they?
Oh, yeah, the Tesla flamethrower. Yeah.
So, and they also announced a quad bike, whether you can buy that as well, I don't know, but you can ride, you can basically ride it up the back of this Cybertruck, and plug it in and charge it whilst you're driving, which is pretty cool. Get off, you know, do a bit of quad biking, why not?
So the truckler's battery charges the quad bike?
Yes.
What now? Hypothetical scenario here. You're driving along, you got your Tesla truck here, like, boy, it's great. You're like, hey, I'm going to go quad biking. Vroom, 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 vroom.
Yeah, but you pull up to Asda. You might want to get around a bit quicker than the average shopper.
Exactly.
Vroom, 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 vroom. Up and down the aisles.
Actually, no, it'd be silent.
True.
It'd be electric.
So this isn't a commercial vehicle, surely?
I think it is.
For like the public?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Well, I know they've already taken 150,000 orders of the truck.
Yeah.
But what? You're saying, I'd be like, I think The Verge put it out. They've already had 150,000. My question is with you guys may be like, I don't have a clue, but with the way cars are going these days, there's dedicated like crumple zones for
any NCAP safety rating.
Exactly. If said, you know, Tesla truck collides with said 2008 Ford Fiesta, I'm gonna die because there's no
you will be a pancake.
Yeah, but then say, you know, that gets to a stage where there's, you know, I'm lucky enough to own a vehicle of that kind, and I collide with another vehicle of that kind. There's no impact crumpling. Is that not like a big safety issue? Am I?
Well, I mean, the bulletproof stuff's on the roads already, so I don't think if that was an issue, I think
your car would just
now
merely bounce off it.
But isn't that?
The idea is it protects the driver. So as long as you're thinking, the idea of a crumple zone is to kind of take some of that impact, but for you it would obviously take the force of that. For them, they might not even dent the car. So as long as both drivers are okay,
wouldn't the driver then take more force because there's no crumpling to absorb impact?
Well, if it's like the truckler, which seems to be like a bulletproof wagon, the force would be distributed evenly across the entire shell. If
I think
they're
saying like
it
could
structure.
Take a hit and it won't the structure won't
warp.
They crumple it because they don't want certain parts of the car to then break into the human.
Cockpit, yeah.
Exactly. So if certain parts give way easier, it diverts that force away from the driver.
Interesting. I always thought I'd ask, because if it's that indestructible, surely just the human inside is just going to bounce around like a bin ball.
Yeah, probably. Who knows? We'll have to wait and see, I guess.
Three-pin harness.
It is quick, though. The top model, which I think goes for maybe like 90K or something. The base model is 40K, which is not too bad.
That's fairly affordable.
The top model, 0-60 in 2.6 seconds. So it is quick. It is awesome.
God, imagine that speed.
Is this dollars?
Yes.
Wow.
So
it's genuinely an affordable vehicle.
Yeah, literally. Yeah. I was speaking to the guy from Happy Fool earlier, and his dad does like caravanning everywhere, and he wants to buy a motorhome. And he's basically said, look, stuff the motorhome, buy the Cybertruck, and we'll just stick a trailer on the back, mm-hmm. which he's considering doing. But, you know, I think it'll be a jaw-dropping moment when we see them on the road.
Especially over here.
They'll come. They'll be here. I don't know when. They'll probably be like 2021, whatever. But, you know, Tesla 3 was announced. And when that was announced, everyone was like, oh my gosh, electric car for the masses. And you think, oh, it's not going to be here for a while. There's loads of them.
I see one in five Teslas these days. They're really common.
Really cool. Another good product, Rode VideoMic NTG. It's an NTG shotgun microphone that you can plug straight into a mic port on a camera, which is amazing. Up to now, you haven't been able to get that sort of shotgun style condensing microphone quality unless you had an XLR port, but now you've got a USB type C powered microphone that you can just plug straight into any camera mic port, which I think is absolutely amazing.
Is that just an advance in technology as a camera guy, that they've managed to get that technology into a smaller jack?
No, it'll be a case of they've managed to get the microphone to, instead of go, well, I mean, you could have done it with an NTG and gone from an XLR to a 3.5mm jack, but it wouldn't be
powered
amazing quality and wouldn't be powered. Whereas with this one, I think it's
from the size of it, they've managed to put a pretty decent battery in it, and
it's rechargeable.
And the cable you plug in, you don't need any adapters. So you can plug it into your phone, you can plug it into your camera. Whereas before, there was like different rings on the end that you need certain adapters for. You can plug this into anything cool. and it will work. So it looks pretty good. Haven't heard any audio quality tests, but it's Rode, so I'm presuming it's amazing.
Yeah.
Good point Bale you put on here. Some Black Friday deals.
Anyone spot anything good?
I am shopping for a graphics card. That's my aim on nice. Friday. Seeing what's around there to help with video editing, gaming, all that lot. Steve, I know he's got a big one on his list.
I'm hopeful. I've heard rumors that I'm looking to get into the tablet world, do all my admin and my finances and my general entertainment alongside a little bit of Lightroom and Adobe Rush from the housing of a Samsung S6 is my plan. A lot of people go, oh, I want you to get an iPad Pro. Me and Will have discussed it in its lengthy chats, but for the bang for your buck, I'll be spending hundreds more on the iPad, and I already own a Samsung, so I get that Samsung link. So I'm hoping it drops sub 500. If it does, could be in my possession.
And I know someone's just made a big purchase. Choo choo!
Hype train!
Announce it to the world. Probably spoke about when we first started this podcast.
I may have ordered a Z6.
Yay!
Yeah, boy!
The mirrorless gang.
Yeah! It should be with me next Wednesday.
Congratulations.
Oh, wow.
I know. Well, I've got contacts. It's great.
You should do a TechNet hands-on review.
Oh, do a live unboxing.
Nice, do that.
I could do. I need to get an XQD card, though. That's the only...
They go for a bit, don't they? Yeah. What sort of prices are you looking at for that?
Quite expensive. They're nearly 200 quid. For some of them. For like big capacity.
Okay, 32 gig XQD card.
Oh, 32 gig XQD card's like about 40 quid.
Oh my God.
I know.
60. Jeez.
I can get a
64
quid on. I can
get 128 gig for about £25 off Amazon.
I know, but it's only that
sweet.
Prices. Although weirdly, on eBay, I keep seeing Nikon branded ones. Which I've never seen. Yeah.
Oh.
Which I find very confusing. There's also Lexar.
I mean, anybody could just print a sticker out, can't
Pretty
they?
Much. But yeah, I mean, Sony seems to be the big player and the only player in
the
XQD
maker of
cards.
It, aren't they? Yeah.
Which
but
I'm
they're
surprised.
They're much quicker than SD cards.
Yes, they're 440 meg a second read and write, which is horrendously fast.
That's good.
And apparently more reliable, allegedly. There's some air quotes.
I've never had an SD card fail, I don't think, touch wood.
I've seen a lot of student ones fail, but that's because normally students yank them out when they're saving
hard
something.
Drives, external hard drives. I've had a few of those fail on me.
I've had internal hard drives fail on me, which was a right royal pain in the backside.
Yeah, I can imagine. Let us know if there's any cool Black Friday deals, as this will be coming out on Thursday. If you spotted anything, let us know. It'll be pretty cool to see what if there's anything we've missed. I think primarily we're kind of looking at Amazon, isn't it? I think they're going to be getting heavy traffic. I'm sure everywhere's putting up some form of sale, quote unquote. Sometimes it isn't, so keep an eye out for that. Lots of cool stuff going on, so keep us looped with that.
Have you spotted anything else on your travels? Any of you on the old black market deals?
Not me.
No. Primarily, I'm looking at a bit of lighting and stuff like that, but primarily graphics cards.
The Samsung watch had a pretty good deal.
Oh, yeah, it was like a
third off.
Yeah, I paid £320 for mine.
It's £1,999 at the moment. £199.
Was it £250 for yours?
No, I paid less than that. Oh. I think I paid that.
Oh, right.
But yeah, like a while ago.
Yeah.
This is just the Samsung watch. So I think
it's the newer one.
It's the newer one.
Yeah. Not like my Gear S3 Frontier. But yeah, otherwise, the only other deals, if you are a Nikon fan, there are other deals on Nikon DSLRs about on the old Amazon. They've got various percentages off from about 13% up to about 39%.
He's a proper Nikon rep now,
no.
isn't he?
Yeah,
well, I've look got, at me, I've my got, Nikon mirrors.
Oh, I've got a t-shirt and everything. That's not a lie. I did see a lot of the kind of like fake GoPro style cameras on offer at
Ross
the moment.
Ross bought one of those. I'm quite interested to hear how he's finding it. He bought one
fake
of those,
pros.
You know, those like 4K, 50
Action
quid ones.
Cameras.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Action camera.
You know, it could be good.
But no, I mean, that literally some of them are going for like 25 quid. And it's like saying 4K, waterproof, all signal dancing. So if you do own one of these kind of fake pros, action camera things, let us know if they're any good. And if they are, you know, we might get some in stock. Who knows? So you can borrow some yourself. But yeah, anything else from the old tech world, Mr. Devereaux?
No, that's going to wrap it up for today.
Fantastic. Now let's move on to a little bit of Tune of the Week. So, Tune of the Week this week, I was kind of struggling a little bit to pick a track because I've just been listening to the Coldplay album on repeat for pretty much every day.
Absolutely.
Everyday life. Look at my link there. Very good album if you like the Coldplay. There's some very odd songs on there which are very kind of Coldplay's being experimental now. Oh, Coldplay's back to normal now. So if you are a Coldplay fan, you'll probably love it all. If you're kind of like I like the hits, you'll of course like, I'd say about 50% of the tracks on there, because some of them are a bit experimental for the fans who aren't super duper Coldplay fans like me. But today is I've picked a different type of band today, an all girl band called Haim. Neither of you ever heard of the band Haim?
No, English, American.
They're three American sisters. They are all sisters of each other. Two of them do look scarily alike, and then there's one that doesn't look like them. So I'm thinking they might be quite close to each other, or like the middle child looks different or something. I don't know. They're okay. All sisters.
All right.
So it's called the band is called Haim. They've got a song called Now I'm In It. It's really quite a nice kind of poppy, upbeat song. The video's quite bizarre. There's a thing in Haim videos where they're always walking down a highway or a street, and the camera's always tracking them as they walk towards the camera, but never reach it, which seems to be a kind of a mantra of all Haim songs when they actually release videos.
Interesting.
They did a video about a year and a bit ago. I can't remember what song it was off the top of my head, but literally the entire video was them walking down a completely empty street in like some suburb of LA, probably at some ungodly hour of the morning, when they could actually shut down the roads. But no, the song's a really nice kind of just a nice pop song, I would say. It was track of the week for Radio 1 like about a month or so ago. They do have another one out at the moment called Hallelujah, which is a bit more kind of downbeat, a lot more mellow. So I thought
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Is that what it is, or Hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's just how you said it. I thought it was
Hallelujah.
I thought it was just Hallelujah.
That's Hallelujah. I mean, that would be amazing if that was that. No, it's Hallelujah. And yeah, it's a bit more downbeat, a bit more mellow, a bit more slow. So I thought I'd pick the more upbeat one, which came out a couple of weeks ago. So,
cool.
Yeah. Haim, Now I'm In It.
Thank you very much.
What I would recommend. I'll chuck that on the old Where's My Kit Bag playlist on Spotify, so you can listen to that and all the other previous tracks of the week. And now it's the good old What Have We Been Watching? So, do we want to start with the thing that we've all watched this week?
Should we end with it? Because I think we've all got a little bit to say about
it. That's a good idea.
In which case, who would like to go first?
On top of the list.
Steve Gale. Okay, let's go to the crime lab.
Steve Gale for 5 points.
So, I've actually been binging series. Two series, one of which I finished, and the other one, it's more of each episode is an individual one. I'm back on the crime hype, so the first one, I've actually written something down. I thought I'll write my thoughts on it directly after the final episode.
Ooh.
It's called The Devil Next Door. It's the, I'll give you the brief description. It's on Netflix, and you might have heard of it. It's a documentary series about John Demjanjuk, a suspected Nazi extermination camp guard known as Ivan the Terrible, who spent years living in Cleveland. Funnily enough, which might be a bit of a hint, he worked as a engineer at Ford Motor Company throughout the 70s, which is a weird segue. However, I'm going to read you what I thought about it. So the thing I found really interesting about this is this could have gone anyway. It's all archival footage.
Cool. I love that.
Which is really good. So they've documented it from, some of it's damaged as well, which is quite good, from like VHS from like the 80s. So basically, this gentleman gets accused of being Ivan the Terrible, claims he's innocent, and then it's a 6-episode limited, I believe, miniseries. And I would admit, episode 3 and 4, they are quite slow, but every episode has something interesting that keeps you, hooked. I'm just going to go on to my notes a second. Which I have not prepared for. One moment.
Segway noises.
And this is literally what I wrote straight afterwards, because one of the things I want to really stress to the people that are going to watch it is if you are of a sensitive nature, I would recommend not watching it. Reason being is they show you a lot of archival footage from these camps in like Sobibor and Treblinka, I believe. And they show you some of the real things that were happening. And what I wrote down, it was a really important documentary in highlighting the significance of those events in its raw format by making us, the audience, extremely uncomfortable by the imagery you see. Personally, I found it unsettling but impactful, drawn out in parts with the trial, but a good piece of content to show how unthinkable and downright inhumane these times were. So just to elaborate on that, there's the way that it's kind of put together is you start to feel bad for Demjanjuk at sometimes, but then they throw you back to what it is he's being accused of, and you're like, oh my god, like, it's really, really quite scarring. And it's I think it's a good time for it to come out, because I think we're over a generation where sadly there's not many people who are around that were alive in those times. And this is something that it explores. And I think this documentary is hard hitting to kind of remind you that these were like the worst times in, you know, human history, arguably. And I thought it was really, really good at kind of bringing that back. And me and Will were talking last night, if you watch a piece of content and you want to read more afterwards, I think it's done quite well. And this is one a perfect example of that. So if you like crime and you like quite unsettling raw material, check it out. It is, it's a really different way that the, you know, the Holocaust was, you know, shown. So yeah, check that out. That was I gave it an 8 out of 10. Reason being is they lost a point on episode 3 and 4 just because the court cases, they did drag on a little bit. But 1 and 2 and 5 and 6 are awesome. And the only other one that I've been watching is the Cold Case Files, again on Netflix. The thing I like about this one is it's very American. And it's, again, this one's done through reconstruction, and they are real cold case files. But the good thing is they're an hour long, and they start from, you know, 1984, whenever the case began. They reconstruct what happened. They kind of leave you a bit of suspense, like most kind of you know, fictional dramas do, and then they kind of go through they interview the real detectives and how they went through their process. But the amazing thing about it is you get closure every episode, so you're not going to watch it and go, oh, you never found out who did it. You do, and that's what the part we're like, oh, let's watch another one.
Is it quite binge worthy in that way?
Yeah,
quite interesting,
because
okay.
You always get closure. I'll admit, in regards to conventional, it is like on the nose. It's exactly that. Let's cut to this, the detective, let him say something that's really like, oh my god, we've got a lead. You know, these drums come in and then the reconstruction kicks in. It's very like that, but it's just nice because you get constant closure, and it's like you go through that process. But these are like 30-year-old cases that get solved by the most minute things, and like technology being advanced into this, that and the other. Or like, it's no spoilers whatsoever, but like people coming forward after like 25 years for one reason or the other, which you're like, how can you wait that long? And then you find out why they waited that long. It's really interesting, and they're from, like, they show some archival stuff if it's relevant. But it's really good. It's called The Cold Case Files on Netflix. Yeah, check that out. That's all I've been watching. Don't know why. I've got a few more of The Cold Case Files to get through. But The Devil Next Door I did finish in its entirety. And obviously the other thing we watched last night, which we will most definitely get onto, but I believe the next person on this list is JB, James Bale.
Hello there. I've literally had no time, because I've been marking constantly. But I have been keeping up with The Good Place, which I thought was coming to an end with the last episode. But when I read, there's more. Oh. And the last episode will be in the new year.
One more episode, or?
I think there might be 3.
Oh, nice.
Maybe 4.
Were they like secret? Did they keep them hush-hush? Or?
Well, I kind of heard musings that there would be like an extended final episode, like a kind of like 40-minuter instead of a 21-er. So I obviously keeping up, Netflix is like literally releasing one a week. So I watched the most recent one, saw it was like the last one on the list. I was like, there are no more. Because obviously on Netflix it's like episode 8 coming out this day, episode 7 coming out this day, or whatever. So 9 was on the bottom of the list. So I was like, this is the last episode. Not my days. But it's not 40-odd minutes long. Something must be wrong. But I watched it, got to the end, and went, that can't be the end. And then I then frantically started Googling online, going, this can't be the end, no! And then, yeah, I found out that the end's actually going to be in 2020.
Wow.
Perfect. So, cool. So the luckily my stressor, the crap ending it had at the end of this episode, is settled. Otherwise, goodness, have I watched anything else? I don't think I have.
Okay.
Hold that thought then.
Yeah. Well, obviously I've seen one thing else, but we're going to mention that after Mr. Will Devereaux.
Hello.
What have you been watching?
Well, sir? first one I'll talk about is a film called Nonstop by Liam Neeson.
Is that the one in the plane?
Yes. Where
I have seen this.
Have you? Yeah,
yes,
yeah, it was quite
I know
good.
This film.
It was, I'd give it 5 out of 10 just off the bat, but it was quite interesting. He's an air marshal on a plane, and the whole premise is someone's kind of hacked into the air marshal network and is messaging him, and they're giving him demands, and essentially they're making it look like he's hijacking the plane. It's quite clever how they do it, and they do reveal like how at first you're kind of like, how is this even possible? Kind of doesn't really make sense, and then they kind of reveal how it goes. But what I love about it is a classic like Cluedo situation where events are happening. You're in a plane up in the air. No one can leave. Everybody's in the room, so you know it's someone on the plane. And you're given sort of like your six potential people, and they're all very feasible who they could be. And I was quite satisfied with the ending, so it's quite interesting. Have a look at that, Nonstop on Netflix. The other one is called Pick of the Litter, which is actually it's a documentary about dogs. It's really interesting.
Nice.
It was great. So essentially, it was like the brutal pick selection process of becoming a guide dog.
Oh God.
Yeah. It is. It so
oh,
but,
man.
So it's like.
I thought this was going to be the film of how you picked your dog Max.
Oh no!
I love that one.
I love
Done.
That one. Yeah.
Film over, Finn.
It was incredible. So they start. I don't know how they must have filmed it over 2 or 3 years essentially. But they start with the litter. There's 8 of them, and essentially they go through. It must be about yeah 2 and 3 years. And as they go through, certain ones make it. Some do. Some don't. Which they kind of like show at the start. But it's just so interesting to see how they learn, the processes, the sort of training they have to go through, the exams they have to complete. Like they have this like special dog car that they drive at 40 miles an hour.
What, the dogs?
Straight at the dogs.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And they
that's
have
even
to,
worse than my
have,
joke.
Yeah. They have to stop and like back up. Otherwise, literally at some points they're like driving the car into the dog. Like not at that speed. They kind of slow down as it, but they like push the dog back. You're like, is this okay?
What the heck?
Yeah.
So right, well, when you said dog exam,
yeah.
Is that the dog sitting an exam? Because all I can see now is a dog just like sat.
Essentially, like, they have 5
just
exams.
Just with like a pencil near its paw, just like... It's just an exam paper.
Well, they get a checkup every 6 months to see if they're still behaving and stuff. And like when you're walking alongside, they can't dart off for any reason, which I know Max does all the time. He like sees like, I don't know, a leaf on the floor. He's like, ooh, leaf.
For clarity, Max is Will's dog.
Yes.
Not a small
Border Collie. and so they can't do any of that. And if they pass that, they go into the selection process, 5 exams. One's like obedience, skills, all that sort of stuff. And then one's like navigating around sidewalks. So, it's just really interesting. They're very cute. It was good. It was heartfelt. And at the end of it was quite a nice, rewarding process as well.
Is that
and
Netflix?
Yes. Wow. Yeah. Pick of the Litter, I think.
Out
it's
of
called.
10, what would you give it?
Probably a 7.
Oh,
it's just,
solid.
You know, if you just want to watch, put something on and be like, you just enjoy watching it the whole time, it definitely tick that box.
Oh.
Speaking of something we enjoyed watching the whole time,
You made a soundbite, didn't you?
Wait, here it comes.
Wait, here we go. That is an actual 4GD40. I managed to find the sound for it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. There you go. Le Mans 66.
Or Ford versus Ferrari. If you're in America.
Yes. Well. Nothing like I was expecting to watch.
I would hint at anybody who's listening who's like, I'm not into cars. Honestly, I would still highly recommend going and watching this film.
Christian Bale, Matt Damon.
I feel. Before
America.
I feel before we continue. Spoiler warning.
Sure.
There we go. Now we're free. We're free to fire.
Okay. If you haven't watched it.
There's your warning.
Yeah, there's your warning.
Heed the alarm.
Yeah. Blimmin' heck. Kind of blew us away, I think, didn't it? Yeah, I mean, we do have the advantage of being all at least familiar with cars and sort of the history of a bit of them. However, I felt I want to see the perspective from somebody who has nothing to do with it, but I don't think it relied on that information at all.
No.
Mm. And I think it wasn't necessarily about the cars. It was much more development of characters, it was just a much more narratively driven story than I was expecting. I loved it.
Oh yes, absolutely. I mean, I knew the premise of the story before going in. I didn't know the whole extent in which the film direction kind of went. So I was expecting a film more like kind of on the lines of something like Rush, which is obviously a bit more focused on the racing and just like two drivers going at it. But this one was significantly more, like you said, like character development, a lot more emotional than I was anticipating, a lot more funny than I was anticipating, because I was just anticipating something kind of more on the lines of, not kind of on the lines of like Senna in a documentary kind of style, but something kind of between Senna and Rush. So a bit of action, but a bit more kind of, not archival more footage.
Intense,
but
serious thriller.
Yeah. A little bit more intense, but it was really funny. I thought Christian Bale played his character brilliantly, just with a mug of tea in his hand, literally for 90% of the film. And then obviously had Carol Shelby's character played by Matt Damon.
I kind of feel like he gave a bit stronger performance, actually. Mm. Personally,
I'm on Team Bale, I'm afraid. Christian Bale, not you, Bale, sorry.
What?
I think just because I'm British and I found it so much more Christian relatable. Bale. Just hearing this, the way some of the quotes he came out with the passion and the energy said, I've heard them from like 40 or 50 different like perky Brits, and I could see it, and it's so of the time as well. Like we don't say those things anymore.
No.
But the way he says stuff, like the way he had his head sticking out of the car after a good lap going, that deserves a bloody cup of tea. Yeah. It was perfect. I love
Come
that.
On, girl.
But I think maybe I'm looking at it subjectively as more of a, it was very nostalgic hearing those lines is why I preferred his performance.
We were laughing through it. I think we all went silent at some points with kind of shock and emotion. And it was just a incredible film, especially for that, we've all been saying, the length of time, 2 hours 30, it's a long film. I didn't know
it was two and a half hours. Jeez.
However, if you go through and think from the start, how many hurdles they go through, from the first sort of racing scene, how many hurdles they overcome and people they face. And I like the idea of that there isn't really one big villain.
No.
Essentially, their team kind of goes through a progression of a series of hurdles that they overcome. I think that's what keeps it interesting the whole time.
So would you argue like Christian Bale's character's first hurdle is the briefcase and the boot, and it just grows from there?
That's it. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah. That is a prime example. And it was quite interesting how it was a perfect representation of, it was his character and the sort of like rowdiness of him against an official.
Yeah.
And that's the same premise of where, Ford was the company that kind of whacked something together, and the official was Ferrari. And essentially that's what they were saying. And then that was your premise for your whole film there.
But yeah, it was, as a very large car fan, especially of the kind of like sports car racing and F1 and all sorts of racing in general, I utterly loved it, of how they portrayed it, how obviously they used, I was surprised we saw so much sort of like test driving, as it were, of them like testing the Ford GT40 at like all its various stages and marks and how many versions they went through. They obviously put a nod to obviously the guys from Lotus, who obviously in the proper story, they mainly built it in a shed over here, and then obviously shipped it to America. And then obviously got Shelby's team to basically just pump it full of gas and see how fast it could go. I thought there was that there could have been more racing, but then I thought the amount of racing that we actually saw, like the drivers in the cars, was like the right amount in the end. Because obviously you're more developing the sort of narrative between him and the team and the sort of conflict going through there. Where you've got the kind of like the suits, as it were, of Ford with like, we want this vision. And then obviously you've got the kind of like more pure-hearted racer of Christian Bale's character, Ken Miles, being a bit more, I'm here to race. Ooh.
Definitely one to see in the 100%. Cinema, like we've all said. The sound is incredible. And I think sort of it's a really nice film about progression, isn't it?
Yeah.
You do go through a whole journey on it.
There's a lot of scenes in it that you could completely analyze in a big power swing. I mean, a lot of them that stick with me also, as you guys both said, had comedy. I think you'll elaborate from this scene to the one that you mentioned when we were talking in the car last night. But the scene with Henry Ford II experiencing the GT40 for the first time.
Yeah.
Amazing. The acting was phenomenal, and it was a really, really funny scene that the good thing was is there was never, my point I'm going to make, which I hope we'll elaborate on, is there was never any like foul play that made a brand look bad.
No.
If you know what I'm talking about with the bolt that you brought up, if you want to elaborate on that.
Yeah. So, well, it was just in general, wasn't it? I think in terms of there were moments where it felt like there could be parts where they might have gone through, like broken the rules to kind of get that edge. But actually, it was complete opposite. They kind of threw the rule book in the officials' faces and say, we can stick to the rules, but still beat you. And I think that was really cool.
Yeah, I think the good thing with it as well is obviously the antagonist grew to be Ferrari in its greatness, if you were going to argue that in a character arc. But there was no... I was sadly waiting for somebody to hit somebody with their car and become the bad guy. And I love the fact it was two manufacturers pushing it until one car literally broke.
Yeah,
and I loved that. I thought that was a really nice touch. Obviously, for context, I didn't know the story. I didn't watch the trailer. I was like, this sounds like something that's up my street. And my dad was a big car head when he was younger. I'm aware of, you know, Le Mans since I was a young boy playing the original grid game in like 2008. So I was aware of all of it. I was like, okay, but I didn't know anything about these people. Obviously, I put two and two together with when I heard the name Shelby. I was like, okay, I'm going to understand that this guy's a pretty big dog with the Shelby Cobras and the Shelby Mustangs. So,
yes, indeed.
I put those two and two together. So if you're not a huge car head, but you appreciate your cars, you know them, you know, you play your racing games when you were younger, you'll love this film. You'll absolutely love this film. So I'll start with the ratings. So I think we're all unanimous.
Yes.
I gave it a 10. Nice. What did you give it, Bale?
Oh, all day 10.
And it's a 10 from me.
Wow, full house. I think it was interesting because we spoke to Ross earlier and I said there was one crash, which I don't really need to get into, that looked a bit janky in its effects, but it was kind of needed for the narrative. But if that's the degree I'm going for criticism, then, you know, it's done fairly well in my book. So, yeah. Cool.
Go and watch it.
I think my favorite moment was obviously when he's sort of like doing that, when Kemars are doing the opening lap of Le Mans, and then obviously a guy kind of crashes and flips. He's like, "Oh, flipping heck!" And just kind of tries around. I'm like, "That's such a British way to react." If only he had a dash cam, and he could have, you know, put it on some YouTube compilation.
You've been framed.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, exactly. But yeah, Le Mans 66 is in cinemas now. Highly, highly, highly recommend to go and see it. If you've ever played a Gran Turismo game in your life, I think you'll appreciate it in some way or another.
I think anyone will.
Yeah.
Oh, God, yeah, absolutely. Even if you don't like cars, I think cars is just the kind of narrative device to take the story forward.
Yeah.
There's so many scenes. We could literally spend 2.5 hours talking about each scene. But,
God, yeah. I happily would.
Yeah, but yeah.
This pod will be too long.
It it's a very. It's arguably more about characters than it is about the vehicles.
Cool. Would you watch it again?
Yes.
Yeah.
100%. Definitely get it on the cinema first. Then I'm getting myself a Blu-ray.
Nice.
Sweet. Otherwise, I think that pretty much sums up another Where's My Kit Bag podcast.
Nice.
We'll be back maybe a different time next week. Potentially. We'll keep you posted. Oh, secrets. But otherwise, I've been James.
I'm Will.
I'm Steve.
And you've been listening to the Where's My Kit Bag podcast. Hey, all, it's Ken here. Thanks for listening to the Where's My Kit Bag podcast. Please feel free to drop us a comment about anything you want us to cover in the section below, or hit us up on Instagram or Twitter at F6 Media Film.